color is better. Hello, hello. God's blessings. Thank you. Thank you, thank you. All right. We're trying to organize a little bit in the back. We know it's in the view of... guys, hello. Turn around. Face the door. Face the door. We're getting ready for children's church. Blessings. Blessings. Thank you, Jesus. Have an awesome time over there. Woo, God is good. All the time. We are attempting to get on the camera live. We have worship in here. It is not live worship, but it is through the YouTube. And then we have a lot of people that are driving over. Well, not when I say a lot, our in-house families, there's a couple of them, you know, kids, six kids come, about five, seven adults, and they drive in from a little bit of a distance. And I had to grab my sweater. Ooh, Florida, come on. I was like, I was already dressed, and then I just caught wind of, like, outside the breeze and the cold, and I'm like, I had to grab a sweater. I didn't care if it matched. It's as good as gold. So God's blessings. Welcome, extended family. We love you. Our prayers are always in your direction for your families. You're part of this ministry. If you're long distance or... you just sign on Sunday, you know, or you come on in here to the facility on Friday nights. We're here. We will gear up to doing some small teachings or different things in the future. I don't know if it's going to be near, but we will. Right now, we're doing a little bit more of, we've got a prayer wall every morning, and you can go jump over to the YouTube channel if you can't catch the prayer wall. Eastern Standard Time, Florida. Between about 9:30, 9:45, we start, and we go all the way till almost 11. 10:45, 11, you know, it's just a little bit of Bible, word, message that's on the heart, and then we go right into prayer. So 45 minutes of one, 45 minutes. You can log on. It's only on social media platform, Facebook right now, but we usually by noon, 2 o'clock, we do upload it over to the YouTube channel, Soldiers for Christ Discipling Ministries, Florida, Newport Richey, Florida. So if you just want to catch some prayer or the message, because we use scriptures in the morning too, the scripture that God puts on our heart or just the multiple scriptures, they're there. So you can also engage on Esther's Crown Prayer Wall. It is a Facebook platform, but it's the whole, like, the video is not me. My phone faces a picture, and I'm just sitting over to the side worshiping God, listening, doing a little Bible study and a lot of prayer. So you're welcome to join in there. If you are close to Newport Richey, we have Friday night. It's just an atmosphere of quiet healing. It's very personal. We light some candles. We put on some worship music. And we just individually, personally sit in quiet time with the Lord. It's not a bunch of people laying hands or doing this or that. You know, God may lead us to that. Some prayer, we have that. That is Friday nights. It's safe to say 5:15, and we go till about 6:30. So that's Eastern Standard Time. That is not live. We don't do that on live. And then we also have Saturday mornings, which... I think somebody asked me last night if you can jump into the spiritual warfare training class. We are going to continue with courses and trainings. And for several or many of you, you may not know, but this ministry is licensed under International Ministries Fellowship, which is a part of ACMA. And that is Pastor Francis Frangipane's ministry. If you want to just Google search him. He wrote several books. He's been in ministry many, many years. He's traveled the world. He is an awesome man of God. We also hold ourselves accountable to other ministries as well, but that is who I am licensed with. And I mean, reputable, established, that's who I'm with. Like, Soldiers for Christ Discipling Ministries is an organization, not for profit, of its own. So it does stand alone as its own, but I am certified and licensed with those ministries. We are going to be doing, I have some good news, and I encourage you guys, we're going to be doing the In Christ Image Training course. Now, I believe the first part is like 6 months, and then the second one, there's a part two, level two, and then you can facilitate the course. You can actually be a facilitator, which I am, and a couple people in here are. I've not done it in many years, so I'm probably gonna refresh myself on the course a little bit. But it's all about the image of Christ in us and the transformed new life. Beautiful, awesome, life-changing. It is by Pastor Francis Frangipane. You can look that up in Christ Image Training. So you can go on there and just research that a little bit. When it's time, we'll make an announcement. We will have it here locally in the building here in Newport Richey. Now, I'm going to ask him for his permission, and that's totally up to him. If he says no, I will honor that. I'm going to ask for the permission to possibly live stream it, but that's going to be up to him, because the thing is, you have to pay for the course. So if you're going to be on live stream, which he may not do this, and it's free, it probably won't work that way. But we'll figure something out. We'll see what he says. Maybe we can Zoom class. If you're not local, you want to be a part of it, you can pay for it. And maybe we can host it in a Zoom, not recorded, not live, but where we can actually connect through Zoom while we're here in the classroom. We'll see. But that's to come in the future. That probably is going to be before the end of this year. So stay tuned on that. If you want to jump into the spiritual warfare class, we are not live streaming that. It's not being recorded. We're here every Saturday, Newport Richey, 6520 Newport Richey Main Street. You're welcome to come as long as you understand. I mean, this is what it's about. It's a course just like In Christ Image is focusing on Christ, the image of Christ. Spiritual warfare is focusing on spiritual warfare. You know, who we are, our position, armor of God, demons, angels, the devil, God. I mean, it just breaks it all down. If you want to be a part, we are about probably 10 weeks in, maybe. It's going to keep going. I thought it was going to be a 10-week course, but I'm looking at probably maybe into May, somewhere June, around there before we end it. We meet here right around 11:30. You don't have to worry about being early. We run through the door. So we meet here about 11:30, and we're supposed to only go to 1:30, but we've been going till about 2. So we're here in location on every Saturday, unless it's a holiday or we announce it on the wall here. We're at in location, spiritual warfare. Even if you didn't start at the beginning, but you want to come sit in, you're welcome to come sit in. Paper pads. It is a long, like 2.5 hour study. We do some prayers. Sometimes we do some activation, some hands-on. We've seen incredible stuff happen. That's why it's private to me, because I know that a lot of people don't want their business out there, and I'm good with that. Between us and Jesus, you know. No offense to anybody. I love platform ministries. I think they're awesome. I like watching healing, deliverance ministries too. But for us, this is what God put on my heart for this season. That may change later. So those are some things that we offer. I'm always available to counsel, you know, if you want to get a hold of me. If you're not on, like say you're watching this on YouTube, you're not on social media right now, or you're watching a replay or whatever, you can email me at, you know, you can message me on Facebook, social media. You can email me though at my first and last name, S-O-N-I-A-D as in David, A-L as in Lori, A-N as in Nancy, O, Sonia Delano at yahoo.com. Email me. And you have a prayer request, please put your prayer request in some of the comments, or try to post it on the visitor wall. There's visitor walls on social media. Again, you can email. We do have a ministry email, but I don't really advertise that as much because I'm not on there as much. Once the website is back up and running, we will offer some different things on the website. I'm just being informative right now. We are going to build a website, and we're going to also offer some of the writings, the teachings, the sermons will be available on there from years. I mean, we've been doing this since 2003. So there's a lot of teachings, and we'll also be offering the book that was published just in September? Hold on. No, I think it was, August, September, which is called The Excellence of God's Love. It is a compilement of sermons and messages that were hand-delivered of the Lord to me, to a group of us that were present during that year of 2013. They're still encouraging.
They're still just as powerful. If you have a desire to go deeper beyond that level of, like, you know, church attendance and maybe a denominational belief system, and you feel that God has more for you, I'd encourage you to get that book. You can go to Amazon. It's The Excellence of God's Love. Just type it in, Sonia Delano, and it's there. You know, it's reasonably priced. If you can't afford it, email me, talk to me. I will get you the book. I don't want anybody to be without something because of money. And everybody knows my heart on that. Like, it's not what any of this is about. Amen. I'm just trying to get my money back from actually hiring an editor and a formatter and the publishing cost of it and stuff. So, and even if I didn't, that's okay. The work's gone out there. God knows about it. So God is good. He's faithful. Amen. I heard you guys went to dinner. That's awesome. Yay. Awesome. I love when I hear that they're going to meet up with you. I'm like, yeah, meet up. And you had the wedding. Awesome. Very good. Did it go well?
Yeah.
Drive was good?
Yeah.
Okay. Safe travels is a key. So I got to tell you, we had an amazing, let me welcome. Welcome. God's blessings. Again, find us here on Facebook, Soldiers for Christ Discipling Ministries, Esther's Crown Prayer Wall, or find us here in sunny Newport Richey. That's very cold today. Florida. Everything's Eastern Standard Time. So you're welcome to join us however you feel to join us. You're always welcome. Amen. And the blessings of the Lord be upon you and your household in Jesus' name. So yeah, we had something awesome happen to us. Oh my gosh. So you know how we've been doing the fast? We started in the first and it's been the Daniel 21. Well, yesterday in our spiritual warfare class, which you could hear, could you hear everything good? Pretty good?
I can hear you. I couldn't hear other people.
That's okay. But you got the conversation. Yeah, the message. So we went into Daniel 10 and we learned about the four areas of demon rulership and how Daniel outlined it as rulers, principalities, powers. And then there was, I don't have them in front of me, but he named four, and then the darkness over a region and things like that. Well, one of them he referenced that he had been praying for 21 days, fasting and praying, and Michael, the archangel, who is just incredibly awesome, I hear, right? Michael breaks through the power of the prince, which was called Persia, and he says, God heard you the very first day that you prayed, but the warfare was so great that this angel was worrying this principality, okay, over this area, broke through that fasting prayer, delivered the answer. He got, you know, what was there. So here we are, we're teaching on it yesterday. And I mean, now, Daniel fast, just to be quite clear about this, we've only done 12 hours a day. So we're doing fruits and vegetables from like 11 in the morning till 11 at night. And then we're going into what we want after that, which is right before sleep. So, but listen, 12 reversed is what? 21, right? So last night we sit down, our meal is like 11. That's how late, because we do coffee all the way up till 11 in the morning and stuff. We sit down, we go to pray, it's Crystal and I. We're praying over the meal, and I immediately get taken into another prayer room. So I'm like prayer closet, Esther's crown, but it's at night before the meal. And I'm in there just praying. I mean, it's powerful. I felt like I entered something I had not entered before. And we both immediately felt a breakthrough that was super powerful. We felt the atmosphere. We didn't see anything, but we knew it. Angels were all in the room. We were just like, whoa. Our ears went open, because she had the same experience I did. Open to where it wasn't, you know how you can hear ringing in your ear because it sounds loud? They opened up and we could hear what sounded like a humming miles away, but it was a faint humming. I said ringing at first, I'm like, no, this was not a ringing. So this is going off and we're just sitting there like, oh my gosh, we just broke through something, right? So she goes, wow, we want more of that. Like, that was awesome. And we started praying for different people and everything. And then I'm sitting there like, we're not even eating. Like, we had a dinner prepared. We hadn't even started eating yet. And all of a sudden, I'm like, oh my goodness. And she's like, what? And I'm like, oh my goodness, yesterday was 21 days. It was 20, this is the 22nd. Yesterday was 21 days, and we've experienced this powerful breakthrough on the 22nd when we actually stepped into prayer. I was like, whoa. And then Crystal said this morning, she's, you know, she got up out of her room and stuff, and she said, I don't think we're ever going to be the same. And I said, well, I hope not. I hope we're never going to be the same. Hello, hello. Hi. Oh, hello.
Sorry.
No, you're joining us today. Oh, so sweet, so sweet. So I had to share that with everybody. If you, and this has been corporate. So what I'm here to announce that if we got that, because it's a corporate fast and it's a corporate covering, that means things should start happening in your lives. Breakthroughs and stuff. Why? You know, one man's faith, when you unite and agree, it is your faith, but just it takes faith to even unite and agree. And I encourage you, we're going to keep going until, like we said, till the 31st. But, and I'm hoping, we may go a second 21 day. I might keep going. This may become a lifestyle. I don't know, but I want to encourage you, God has done something for everybody, not just for me. For Daniel, it belonged to his men, and it belongs to all of us, and it belonged to that atmosphere that Daniel was walking in. So let's pray, and then we're going to get in a powerful word. I've got a lot of scripture. I want to get started right away, okay? Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. All right, well, Father, we just thank you for this encounter that we've had, for this breakthrough, God. Through fasting and prayer, your word has taught us that you're the God of the fast. You're the God of the prayer, of the breakthrough, that when we step out to do things for you, you supersede everything we can imagine. So, Father, for that experience that Crystal and I had to just break through into that realm through this fast, I pray it for everyone, God. When you make happen for one, you can make happen for all. God, I believe that you're no respecter of person, that what you make available, we can all come to the table. We can all receive. We can believe for one another that even the gifts and fruit and callings will come that even supersede what we thought for ourselves or for others, God. Make us one in the Spirit. Walk us through this life connected, God. May there be no disconnect in any one of us. Today, we lift up our family members, God. We just cast our burdens. Right now, I pray you lift every burden as we release them to you, God, that we can sit in an atmosphere of clarity, our ears open, our eyes open, that we'll be able to see. May the deception fall off, the lies, the hurts, the pain, God, come in and flood our hearts with that light, spotlight the things that you want to do for each and every one of us. May our faith not fall short. May our faith be found in you and in all that you do and all that you say that you do, God. We give you our praise today. We speak to you, Father, in concerning all of the things, the cares, God, concerning the people, the plans, this nation, the nations of the earth, and we declare your word and your praises. We call forth the provisions of heaven. We call forth the plans that you have over us and our households, God. Fill us today. Strengthen in every place in us. May the feeble knees be made strong, the minds be revived and renewed, and our souls just come to this place where we acknowledge not just spirit, but soul, mind, will, and body comes to the place to be sanctified, acknowledging you in our walk in this life. We give you praise, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Is anyone cold or warm? I'll adjust. Everybody's good. Okay, because this is kind of lengthy. We got to go at it pretty good. Pens, pencils, paper, take some notes. If you have a second phone or you're on your TV and you have your word on your phone next to you, be encouraged. God's going to speak something. He may give you some revelation about a scripture you never knew. He may speak directly to you. I'm going to go grab a water. My helper forgot my water. I'll be right back. So be patient with one another too. Amen. Sometimes we're busy, we're distracted, we're trying. Now, anyone else need anything while I'm going? I'll grab you something. We're good. You want a water? Okay. All right. I'll be right back. Thank you. I mean, I rocked out and had my blue and gray on, and I was ran out, started to go out the door. I'm like, it's cold, and I'm digging through my sweaters because I really, my winter stuff, in Florida, you don't have winter and summer, right? Everything's kind of blended because winter's very short, cold's not all the time. So I'm looking for something gray, right? I'm digging, nothing, right? And I finally found this. I said, I wonder whose this is. I was like, where did this sweater come from? Might have been one in the ministry. Somebody left it behind. I think it was my mom's. At some point, this is going to spill. Yep, there it goes. They don't make the water bottles like they used to. They feel thinner, right? They kind of crumble in your hand when you're trying to open them. Like this one got all, and that's the Zephyr Hills, too. Oh, thank you. That's good. Yeah. All right, so here we go. Go ahead and write the title of this message down. We're going to be talking about being built up in Christ, being built up in Christ. And the work of the Holy Spirit in you. Being built up in Christ and the work of the Holy Spirit in you. We'll start off in 1 Corinthians chapter 6. Thank you, Jesus. Being built up in Christ and the work of the Holy Spirit in you, in me. You know, sometimes we're like, oh, if I can get to that church, the Holy Spirit will be there. Holy Spirit's in you. Amen. Holy Spirit's in you in your home. Holy Spirit's in me in the car. In the time when you got to go face something hard, Holy Spirit's there. You don't want to go to the school, you're not going by yourself. Holy Spirit's there, amen. I said this morning, we can create an atmosphere. We can light candles. We can put worship on. You know, we can get the atmosphere going for God. Absolutely. But Holy Spirit, when they say, I want to go to that place because the Holy Spirit's there. No, the Holy Spirit is in you. The Holy Spirit is in me. We're smarter than that stuff. When they say, come over here. Holy Spirit's over here. You just tell them, Holy Spirit's in me. So if I come there, I go there. I come, Holy Spirit's coming with me. Amen. They'll tell you that. They'll tell you he's residing in some tent somewhere. That's where moves are taking place. Power, agreement. Right now, if two of us are in total agreement, guess what? Things start to happen. Answers start to come. Yeah. So being built up in Christ, the work of the Holy Spirit in you. So once we come to know Christ, this we have to settle. Our life is no longer our own. Doesn't belong to us. We got to put to rest that independent, well, I can do what I want. I'm going to heaven anyway. Come on. We got to put to rest. Bury that doctrinal wrong mindset. That is not even, it doesn't even accurately describe the new creation. All right, so we're going to get rid of that and invite in this this knowing. Once we come into Christ, we receive him. This life as I now walk and live it, it's no longer mine. So we're going to 1 Corinthians chapter 6. And this is where I also went this morning. In Esther's Crown Prayer, the group I was telling everyone about this morning, or this afternoon. We're going to start in verse 12, and I'm going to go through 20, because we have a lot of ground to cover. So 12, 6, 1 Corinthians 6, 12 through 20. Okay, verse 12. All things are lawful for me, but all things are not helpful. All things are lawful for me, but I will not be brought under the power of any. Foods for the stomach and the stomach for foods, but God will not destroy both it and them. Now the body is not for sexual immorality, but for the Lord, and the Lord for the body. Someone here? If you want to lock, check the door, see if it, excuse us 1 minute. Did you lock the door? Is someone here?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay. Is it Kim? Or?
Yeah.
Because if not, you can lock it back until they... Is Kim on her way?
Yeah, that's her.
Okay. All right. So now, well, I know you... Okay, your car is the same color, but I think you brought... Did you? Okay. All right. Perfect. So now, let's go back here. So food for the stomach for foods, God will destroy both in and them. Now the body is not for sexual immorality, but for the Lord, and the Lord for the body. And God both raised up the Lord and will also raise us up by his power. Do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ? That's what we were talking about to begin with. Shall I then take the members of Christ and make them members of a harlot? Certainly not. Or do you not know that he who is joined to a harlot is one body with her? For the two, he says, shall become one flesh. But he who is joined to the Lord is one spirit with him. That's what I said. It's no longer our life. You're one with the Spirit. Oh, after she comes in, probably. She probably won't know that.
Hello, hello.
Sorry. It's okay. But he who is joined to the Lord is one spirit with him. Here, flee sexual immorality. Every sin that a man does is outside the body, but he who commits sexual immorality sins against his own body. Or do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you? That's why I say he's not going to, you know, the atmosphere, we can create an atmosphere, but the Holy Spirit is going to flow through you and I. Amen? So it's the temple of the Holy Spirit who's in you, who you have from God, and you are not your own. Question mark. We're not our own. We should know this. For you were bought at a price. Therefore, here's our part here. Glorify in your body and in your spirit. Glorify the members which are God's. Now, I didn't want to read all, but I did want to point out a couple things here. So the work of the Holy Spirit in your life, my life, verse 17, is, if you want to look at that again, we're in 1 Corinthians chapter 6. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, and we're looking at verse 17. Thank you, Jesus. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 17. So the work of the Holy Spirit in your life, my life, verse 17, is to make us one with him, if you want to write that down. The work of the Holy Spirit, 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 17, we're PowerPointing that, is to make us one. This is unity. Without that, we're not going to be one to God. We're not going to be one to the things of God in unity. We'll disagree with it. I don't know. God says that, but I don't know if I believe that. No, he said it. We need to believe it. Amen. We just got to settle those things. Doubt and unbelief prevents miracles, signs, and wonders. And we know that. I have walked my life many times in doubt and unbelief. I'm going to tell you something. If you're going through that, that means that fear is trying to prevent you from stepping into that faith realm where everything is possible. So it's not your fault. Even the man Jesus said, because of your doubt, you know, he didn't say, oh, I won't doubt anymore. He said, help. God will never cast away someone who cries out for help or calls out for help. Right? Yeah, he's not going to. He says a bruised heart, a heavy heart. He by no means, not just maybe, by no means will cast out. Matter of fact, it put the exclamation point after your scripture. Yeah. In this world we're in right now, the best thing you can do is have your mind renewed to the things of God. I tell young women, young men all the time, if you want to know who the one is that you're supposed to marry without complicating and then somehow getting them in one day, then get your mind renewed. And you'll know. What does it say in Isaiah, is it 26, I believe? It says, those whose mind is stayed upon the Lord, that one will be in perfect peace. Because she trusts in God. Amen. Isn't he good? Now, say you did drag somebody in or pull them into the, you know, marriage or kingdom or whatever it is. Pray for them. And maybe it was the one God had and you got to go through some bumpy grounds and stuff. Pray. Pray. I told someone yesterday, I said, they called me for a little bit of a conference call. And I said, listen, I taught husband a little bit of stuff. I said, are you two not one flesh? Yes. I said, then why aren't you calling things that are not as if they are for that other part of your flesh? You own that right. I said, if you're standing here as a woman of God, or let's say it's a man, you're standing here in full authority, walking in Jesus, and the other part to that marriage is not, You're one in the eyes of the Lord. You have every right. The two become one flesh. That's what the devil doesn't want. That's called authority. You start standing over your other, the other half of what is one before the Lord. Remember when I told you, pray over the fruit of your womb, your children. Blessed are the fruit of my womb, whether they're still in there or not. He said, I set before you life and death, the blessings and the curses. Choose life, that you and your offspring, those that came out of your womb, shall live. Yeah. Choose life. Choose this day. That was last week's message. I'm not going back there. We're moving on. So ultimately, look at the work of the Holy Spirit in the Word, verse 14. Same chapter, 1 Corinthians 6, verse 14. And God both raised up the Lord and will also raise us up by his power. So ultimately, while the work of the Holy Spirit's going on in our life with the word while we're here, the ultimate goal is we're going to be lifted off of the earth. We're going to be raised up. Right now we're being seated. We're being positioned. We're being built up, okay? The Holy Spirit, he is possessing our temple. You're not alone. You know how one day you're like walking in your Christian faith and everything seems like, I don't know, I don't see all this. And then the next minute, the light's on, you're like, oh my gosh, it's been here the whole time. Because it didn't just suddenly come into you. It's that your, like he said about the flesh, your person came in agreement. The life is no longer your own. See, my life, they're like, well, how do you know this is what God wants you to do? Because I laid it down for him a long time ago. You know, I said, God, not my will, but yours be done. That's a hard prayer. That's what Jesus prayed in the garden when he was about to go to the cross. If this cup can pass, nevertheless, God, nevertheless, Father, not my will, but yours be done. That's how they end up in missionary fields and give up their families and their careers and their money and everything else and go serve the hungry and the homeless and the destitute and those that are broken and have no shoes on their feet and stuff. How do they do that without surrendering their own will in life? I tell you, the ones that don't do it on that side come running back. I'll never do that again. You know, come on, be real. I'm never going to do that again because it's too hard. If you're anything we do, parenting, having children, I hear some people, I'm not having any more. You know? I am not having another child. You know, some people in a broken marriage, I'm never marrying again. There's just, this is the flesh. Okay, so we want to come over here and say, Holy Spirit, how can I help you? You know what's on my fridge? Help me to help you, God. I wrote that on a piece of paper, a green piece of note, little notepad paper. And I put two magnets to it. It's right there every time I open the fridge. Help me to help you, God. What do I got to do, Lord, to become less obstinate, less disagreeable? You know, hey, we wander at our own hands, not because of God. And oftentimes in the lack of knowing, that's why we want to partner with Holy Spirit. If you want to put that down, I want to partner with the Holy Spirit. The good beauty of this is he didn't leave us alone. Jesus said to his disciples, they're like, don't go. We don't want you to go. Stay, Jesus. He said, if I don't go, I can't send the one who can be everywhere and can teach you all things. Some of the greater works we're going to do that he's talking about, you know, we think, I'm going to be more powerful than Jesus. No, he was limited. Some of that has to do with being limited. The more, because he can only walk in his body and send the word and be around a select people. Now by the Holy Spirit, we're doing greater because we're multiplying. There's more number. We can reach more. Same gifts, same superpower, natural power, same kingdom, right? But now there's a lot of us. Holy Spirit is in all of us. The devil would like it just shut us down and sit us somewhere falling asleep every week in a pew and saying we're doing our time. If you ask somebody why they're something, like if they say, you know, I'm a Presbyterian, and they're like in their 20s or something, and you ask them why, they're going to say, well, my parents, you know, that's the church we went to, that's the school my parents put me in. That's the understanding of why they follow a denomination. So as we get raised up, God is taking us out from us and finding and seeing, why are you following me? You know? He told Peter, do you love me? 3 times. If I was Peter, I would have been broken down with tissue boxes all over. Why, God? Of course I love you. And he did. He said, you know I love you, Lord. Then feed my sheep. Feed my lambs. Feed my sheep. See? Because why? Peter could get tempted like the rest of us to go out and make a living. He might have gone back to doing what he was doing after Jesus left. Listen, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. And we're not talking about a fear like Satan puts. It's a reverential awe that he is almighty, all powerful. He's able to do everything he said he could do. He is not a man or human that he's going to tell us a lie. Or say, I'm the father of this house, and they're running it like a reckless ship all over the place. One day up, next day down. One day they believe in God, next day they're mad. That's not Father God. Amen. Good Father. So, this is the union that me and you have with the Holy Spirit, verse 17. And let me say, front row over here, shedding some tears. You know, when God was changing me on the inside, I cried every week that I went to church. For years. I'm like, here I go again. I was like, you know, I felt like it was a small place too, where everybody could hear you and sniffling and everything else. And I was like, Lord, why do I have to cry every week? Why do I have to cry? He was making me the woman that he wanted me to be. He was making me the daughter that he desired for each one of us, or the son for the men. Being transformed into the image and likeness of God. Amen. That's for you, for me, for us, brothers and sisters. God wants more. Go ahead and say that. God wants more.
God wants more.
He wants more. Say it, extended family, you too, or type it. God wants more. It's his desire to bless us. It says it's his good pleasure to give us the kingdom. His good pleasure to give you everything that was for them. Yes, Lord, more. More in Jesus' name. More in Jesus' name. More. More. Pour in. Pour out. Overflow. Cup overfloweth. More. Fresh starts. New beginnings. Greater wisdom. More. Hallelujah. Pour it, God. Pour it on. Hallelujah. So they're afraid to talk like that to someone else. They might take their pulpit or something. Take it. Well, you know, leave me something to lean on. I lean on this. Crystal laughed at me. I go, what's those stains on the side? I went to wash it. She goes, I think that's the makeup on your hands. I'm like, oh my gosh. She goes, Pastor, you don't recognize what you do. I said, what do? She said, you grab the sides of it all the time. I said, I do? She goes, yeah, you hold on to it like it's going to take off. I said, I know. I said, I'm known for that. She goes, yeah. I go, oh my gosh, I didn't realize I grab it. Oh, I better go. You know, some people start running. They start running through the church. They take off. They, you know. It's like they start jumping up and down like in a bouncing. I do that, and I'm going to be sore later on. You got to exercise to get in those kind of movements. Whew. So this is the union we have with the Holy Spirit, verse 17. We're joined to the Lord. We're one in spirit. I remember someone asking me one time, do you believe that all, this is how they challenge you. You come into preaching, they start asking you these complex questions. Do you believe that all sin is the same? This is what they asked me, and they were testing me, and I said, no, I don't believe that all sin is the same because of what we just read here, specifically verse 18. Right here, verse 18, flee sexual immorality. Every sin that a man does is outside the body, but he who commits sexual immorality sins against his body. So there's sin outside of the body, and there's sin that pertains directly to the body. So every sin is not the same. So I was able to answer them. Now, specifically what we do know is that all sin is forgiven. And all sin has been nailed to the cross. So when I answered that, I said, not every sin is the same. Some sins are outside of the body. Some sins are directly inside the body related to sexual immorality. It says it right here. I said, but if you're asking me if he's forgiven at all, yes. See, you give him the answer that you found in here, and then they walk away and try maybe come back with another question. I don't know. told Kim yesterday, I said, just go home and tell them, listen, I was not there when Adam was in the garden. Why don't you search for Adam? You know what I'm saying? Go ahead and search for Adam. And when you find something out, like if you discover Adam out there and you find something out, you come back and ask me. Why? Because they're not looking for an answer. They're looking to insult her relationship with the living God. You've got to know why they're coming. Jesus was led as a lamb to the slaughter, and he opened not his mouth. Pride is a work of the flesh, Galatians 5, and it'll rear up and say, go ahead and answer them. Go ahead. You know, no, you just got to know from the closer you walk with the Holy Spirit, the more you're going to recognize when somebody is coming for your crown, coming for something you gained in the Lord. He said, don't cast your pearls before swine. Pigs, meaning, not he's not, listen, otherwise they'll trample on them. That's the words of our Lord. They'll trample on them. They'll trample them. Everything valuable to you and God will be trampled under their feet, as if in what you carry, what you earned or gained means nothing. Don't let them trample on the pearls you're getting. Amen? Amen. Woo. So, we are, did we hear this? Yeah, these windows, you think they're thicker. Did they keep going or are they parked? They're probably cruising by. Usually they're just driving by. Yep, there they go, right? You know, you think with all these windows and stuff, it'd be thicker. You know, you wouldn't hear as much. I remember the first time I was preaching and the ambulance went by. I'm like, like, what? Oh my gosh, those are like thick, hefty windows, though. So. Okay, we're just talking in here. We're coming back now. So, we're the temple of the Holy Spirit. That's what he said right here, verse 19. Or do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have from God? You're not your own. So our life is not our own. The good news is that the Spirit of God is residing on the inside of us. Don't you ever feel alone again, please. I pray in the mighty name of Jesus that no one in this ministry, extended family, ever feels alone again. You never feel alone again, in Jesus' name, never. Thank you. Hold on 1 minute. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. I just pray right now that the increase of the Holy Spirit come forth, that this feeling of being alone or misunderstood, fear, whatever it is, in Jesus' name, we just bind it in the name of Jesus. We pray peace into this vessel right now, peace that passes all understanding. What the enemies meant for harm, in Jesus' name, will be fully recovered and restored and renewed and revived, and will come forth as diamonds, as pearls, as rubies, as gems. I pray an overflow of wisdom out of this vessel of honor, vessel of light, that the enemy will not trouble the ears, eyes, mind anymore. Come, send your angels to wrap around her in Jesus' name, God. Your will be done. You come forth in her body according to your goodness and kindness and good measure, God. No more. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God. Cover all. Thank you, God. Yes. Plant those seeds of goodness, righteousness, love, faith, hope. Plant those seeds, God. Greater wisdom, increase, fruit, long-standing fruit, God. Thank you, God. Yes, in Jesus' name. Amen. Yeah. I remember my days, oh my gosh, when God was raising me up and the enemy thought he had some power over me, and I thought he did too, and oh my gosh, it was, whew. What did Jesus, one of the first things Jesus said, I've come to set the captive free, to set liberty. In Isaiah, the prophecy from the prophet Isaiah, he said, he'll come to set liberty to those. The devil is a liar. Liar, capital L. He does not come to be friends. He doesn't want to play patty cake. He lies. And he's a defeated foe. He's been defeated. We learned yesterday, if a third of the angels fell with him, this was awesome. You know, we don't think like this, because when we're under the oppression of the enemy terrorizing us, or people, words, and life, we don't, our mind doesn't catch quick. That's why we got to get the word in here and live in the Holy Spirit. But we learn there's two angels for every demon. So the demons are outpowered just simply by the angels in the angelic realm. We don't even have to do a whole lot if we get our angels on them. Call forth. Charge the angels. They're there for us. One, two angels to every demon. How is that so? Because a third fell with Satan, which left two-thirds still with God. So if the demons are being commissioned by the devil to go out and do what they do, that means the angels are being commissioned by God and us to go do what they need to do. Come on, be encouraged. Yeah. God has angels assigned to people. I've never really sought this or asked because I don't go seeking angel doctrines or anything, but I have heard testimonies where angels have actually told men and women of God their name and told them in a meet and greet, in a dream and stuff, I'm assigned to you. My name is such and such. I mean, powerful. This isn't made up stuff. This is the kingdom of God. Behold, the kingdom of God is at hand. You shall cast out. You shall lay hands. You shall commission others. You shall go forth. Disciples go out and they make disciples. They just gather together. Go into the world, discipling. Amen. Hallelujah. I'm a disciple. Whatever tag they want, I'm still following God. I'm following the Lord. Paul said, follow me. He called himself the least of the apostles that was given the honor of writing all those books. And yet he labeled himself as least. Wow, what a revelation there. He said, if you want to be exalted, then be abased, humble. Sit at the feet of Jesus. Talk to him out of where you're at. Talk to him just like you are talking. You talk to me. Well, you know, some conversation. October came, some conversations. But talk to him like that. He's waiting. The narrative is that he wants you to speak. He wants to talk. He wants you to go places in him. Amen. Share your heart with him, okay? Share your heart. So let's go over to the work of the Holy Spirit combined with the Word. So we've established this. The Holy Spirit comes into this temple. We temple him to bring unity to our spirit and his spirit. So we're never alone, okay? So next, we're going to go over to some of his work in the ministry of Christ. 1 Peter chapter 2. And listen, I got out of it. What time did we get out of Esther's crown? Was it? We got out late. 10:45 or something? 10:45? I think so. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I went into this word. So this is home cooked. I sat out there like, okay, Lord. You ever do that with God? Like, it's getting near the deadline. I haven't heard you yet. First, I don't have my Bible. Well, I have my Bible with my tabs, but I really like this. I call it cheating, being able to get to verses. 1 Peter chapter 2. Let me get my tab Bible. Because I have way too many markers in here. 1 Peter chapter 2. And my vision. It would help if I put my glasses on. I think that. I'm still trying to act like I don't need them. I ran into somebody yesterday that wears contacts, and they're like, or they don't wear contacts anymore. I said, I like your glasses. She goes, I used to wear contacts, but I was having to wear my contacts with my reading glasses. So I was like, forget this. So I just went to glasses and I looked at her because that's what I did. I got contacts and I got reading glasses on. Okay, 1 Peter chapter 2. Now remember something about this powerful union we have with Holy Spirit. Here, I want to drive this home. Never alone. Never alone. The point of the Holy Spirit coming into you to live in you with salvation is that you never have to walk this life alone. So please remember that. Don't you let anybody ever tell you you don't have the Holy Spirit. If you have Jesus, what we need to do with the Holy Spirit is get closer, get connected, stay one with him, talk to him. Talk to him, he's in you. Amen. Don't worry about what anybody else says unless they have something stronger in the Lord that they can impart to you. Otherwise, you just respect him. I'm not telling you to be mean to anybody. You can be gracious and dismiss what somebody's saying. Right? and just carry on. Don't let him take that peace you gain for sure. All right, we're going to start in verse 1. 1 Peter chapter 2. Be ready. Verse 1. Therefore, putting aside all malice and all deceit and hypocrisy and envy and all slander, like newborn babies, long for the pure milk of the word, so that by it you may grow in salvation. You may grow by the word, the milk of the word, the pure. So I'm going to stop there a minute. Growth. So your next, the next key point to this, you got unity, you got your union with the Holy Spirit, which is already given to you. Now you've got growth. Okay? So we have union, oneness, and through what? The work of the Holy Spirit, the word, we have desired, in verse 2 on the New King James, like newborn babes, desire the pure work of the word. Yeah, milk. So he's saying the sincerity of God's word, and now look, if you'll desire it, you'll grow by it. There's another key. If you'll get a desire, like salvation, like some people want to go and own all the gifts and own all the titles, and those things are good, okay? But the more excellent way is that we desire a relationship with the Lord, with the Holy Spirit, engaged in the word every day. If you never step up to a platform, I said they take the pulpit that I hung on to, like if you never have a pulpit, allow the place of your life to be that platform with God. Yeah. You know, after cancer, during that whole battle with cancer, I was telling someone that a lot of people didn't understand about me. God called me. I had been in the pulpit for, gosh, 17 years, I think. I don't know. I don't even know how long it was, but a long time. And God called me away from it. You guys held it all together while I was gone. But God called me away from it. He called me out of my job. He called me out of ministry. He called me out of the rescue. And he called me to sit down while this battle was going on and just talk to him day and night, night and day, day and night. And that went on for nearly 6-8 months. So I encourage you, if you need a getaway with God, you know, that I'm not saying missing church and stuff, but you, your life, maybe it's a day, maybe it's a week. He can do things like that. 21 days, we just saw a breakthrough. And I had no idea that in 12, but reversed as 21. So I was like, look at that. He even recognized it. He even honored. He'll honor effort. He honors effort. You ever get like when you're a kid or you got the kids in school and they're like, well, you really didn't do good over here, but because I like what you did here, I'm going to up your grade a little bit. You know, I'm going to give you a little star on your paper. That's effort. They say that when you're not hearing God and you're in a test of your life, they say, don't worry when you're taking the test. That's when the teacher is the most quiet. So make sure you're staying there with the Lord. Make sure you don't have to worry about what anybody else is doing in their relationship. You worry about you. This is one of my life phrases, like a catchphrase between me and the Lord. How is it between us, God? How are things between us, God? And it doesn't mean that I don't have family, you know, issues. I don't have financial issues. I think we all are kind of burdened with something that we have to keep giving to the Lord or keep dealing with and combating. But I want to know how it is. And everybody should want to know how, and we're going to learn that. Let me keep going, but that's in this message, is to actually self-examine and examine your relationship with God, you know? Most marriages would probably survive, or a percentage of them, if they would examine them on their own self instead of the other one. See, it's easier for me to look at Crystal, like in our walk with Animal Rescue, and go, you're doing this, 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 and this, and her look at me and go, well, you're not doing this, this, you know, but then me to take an internal examination of myself. Or her too, right? Some people say, well, we're just agreeing to disagree. I'm like, what? That doesn't solve anything. That means it's unresolved, because that means there's something in you that's still disagreeing. Here the word says, unless two be agreed upon, they can't walk together. some of the issues we could resolve before we marry is, do you believe in private school or public? What kind of faith do you have? What denomination? Where do you believe we go at the end of this journey? Some of that stuff will be spilled out right in the beginning, you know? Will you never cheat on me? You know, how do you know? You know, start to get deep in there. I remember years ago with Turner, he said something about somebody. I go, what's her middle name? And he just blank stared at me. And he goes, well, gee, I don't know it. And I said, well, you're in a relationship. This wasn't, you know, before. I'm like, how do you not know somebody's middle name? How do you not know these things? I sat my daughter and her husband before they were married. I sat them down. God actually led me to do this. I sat them down and said, what's her favorite? They answered like this. What's his birthday? What's his mother's name? What's his goals and them? I mean, I was taken back at how much they knew about each other. And as much as I didn't want to accept some things just because nobody was going to be good enough for my princess, okay? I said, as personal as you want to make this, ask her what my standard is. Amen? So anyway, but they knew so much about each other that I realized something. God had me do that. When I walked away, I cried. And I said, God, they're friends. Only friends would take the time to know that much about each other. And every marriage should be built on a friendship. Every single, and if you're not friends anymore, then you got to get before the Lord. Hey, I had somebody call me to counsel about their marriage, and I had heard the Holy Spirit go, tell them to stare into each other's eyes until the breakthrough comes. What I didn't know was they had confessed out of their mouth, I can't even stand to look at you anymore, which is common in marriages. I didn't know that. So it was told to me. After I said, I don't know why he wants you to just gaze into each other's eyes until something breaks. And one of the people said, I know why. Because out of our own mouths, we've said we can't stand to look at each other anymore. I said, well, gee, Lord, just stare for a while. You know, when you fall in love, it's by looking in their eyes and say, oh, look right through me. Like, just like, oh, the eyes, something about the eyes. Come on. Let's pray. Father, help the marriages, God. Strengthen the marriages that are in this ministry out of the goodness and grace of who you are, the vows, the covenant, the friendship. Lead them in the way they should go. Help each one of them to partner better with the other, to understand your plan, God, to follow the leading of your word and your spirit for marriage, God. I pray a unity like not known into the Christians' marriages, those that belong to you in the church, in the tents, in the cities, in the states, nations, the marriages, God, that covenant being made strong. May there be a friendship that enters into the covenant of Christian marriages from this day forward by heaven's release, God, by the power of the miracle of your word being spoken, that the two become one, God. I pray angels be placed around the homes and the families, Lord, that they will cooperate with your word and your plan, and that the enemy will be confounded and dismayed, because in disbelief he will stand there at the awe and wonder of what only you could do. Wonder working God, miracle maker, way maker, light in every dark situation. Bless them, Lord. Bless and just prosper, multiply and increase the marriages, God, and families, Father. Thank you, Jesus. In Jesus' name. Amen. Ooh, that was a nice release for the marriages. He'll work on what you give him. He'll work on what you work out, right? Work out what God is working in. That's the word. That's in his word. Work out what God is working in. So he's already at work in you now. You go ahead and release it and work it out. I pray the most blessed marriage over you in the name of Jesus, that it supersedes what you even thought in days to come, God. You see the cries. You see, you hear, God. You're the God who is able. You know, when Hagar was running got ran out into the woods, right? And cried because Sarah was like, okay, now I convinced this and now I'm mad at you. And she's out there in the woods and everything else. And the angel appears to her. And now, you know what her statement was? He's a God who sees me. He's the God who sees me. We read this stuff like it's ancient. Like it's a good old history book somewhere. No, it's the letter, the love letter. It's the instructions. It's our manual. He's the author. He authored this. Same Holy Spirit. Don't let anybody put some dry spell on you. Oh, you know what Galatians says? Oh, foolish Galatians. Here, who has bewitched you? All right, the Holy Spirit's going to take us on a little tour. Hang on. I love when he does this. We're going on a tour. You ever watch The Love Boat? Right, back in the day? Or Gilligan's Island, three-hour tour. We're not going that far, though, because I got a message. Unless he goes there, I'll just say that. Okay. Let me read this. This is a different version. Let me get in my New King James. I like the New King James. Powerhouse in these translations. Okay, here we go. I don't have it in there. Very good. Okay, chapter 3. Galatians, chapter 3. Verse 1. O foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you that you should know that you should not obey the truth, before whose eyes Jesus Christ was clearly portrayed among you as crucified? Now listen, bewitch means to curse or spell. So this whole body of believers, this whole people, can you imagine Paul's job? We think our job's hard. Listen, the justification is by faith. Abraham, when he came to the Lord, and he was like, the Lord said, Abraham, your righteousness is counted as faith because why? Because you believed what God said. So here, we start believing the word, but then it goes on to say, only I want to learn from you. Did you receive the Spirit by working of the law or by the hearing of faith? We didn't even come to God by working it. That's when we were having trouble all those years. And then finally an encounter with Jesus happened and we're like, whoa, this is the best thing in my life, right? So it's by faith. So he's like, don't let anybody trick you or bewitch you. Your relationship mounting up on wings of eagles is going to be because of your cooperation with the Holy Spirit that's already in you. There is no more to be done other than produce what is already happening, what's been paid for, paid in full, stamped, sealed, delivered. There is no more to do other than receive the gift and walk in the fullness of it. There's deception in this stuff that they try to interpret it. And they mean well as they're taking your money and leading you to a slaughterhouse of unforgiveness, of bitterness, of rejection, of refusal. You know what the word said? They will not only not go in and experience kingdom for themselves, they'll stand at the door and prevent you from doing so. They'll tell you, don't go back to the place. There's no such thing as women preachers. You know, an 18-year-old won't lead a worship team. And yours will. Amen. You plant seeds. She already gave you the verse and stuff. There's going to be one raised up right in the middle and that has a lot more sense. In a good way. Come on. God speaks, Ken. He speaks in his creation. Go outside and gaze upon the stars and just see the beauty of how they do exactly what they're supposed to do. I tell people, thank God we can't control the moon. We'd have already messed it up. We wouldn't have any nighttime light. Amen. Or the stars. If we could get our hands on that. Every day I wake up, every single day I wake up, and I say, this is your day, God. You made it. I didn't make it. So whatever happens in it is us. He made the new day. Yeah, he made the new day. Just step in it and go, this is your day, God. It really is simple. It's just we believe the lie so long that the simplicity of this is hard to be convinced of anymore, you know? All right, back on track. That was the Holy Spirit interfering on us. So that's Galatians chapter 3, if you want to write it down. Just your justification, we've been justified by faith. Through the grace of God, our faith to say, yes, he did it. And then the love that we have, that we continue to, because he first loved us, our response is an appreciation. Thank you, Jesus. I think I'll visit with your scriptures today. Amen. I think I'll read your love letter to me today.
Amen.
Amen. It's like, people are like, do I have to read the word? I'm like, you should watch. I mean, have to. They come to me with all kinds of stuff. Wait till you start. I'm telling you, start taking this, you get. I told you, they asked me. They were trying to trick me that day. Do you believe all sin is the same? Trying to take away from the finished work of the cross, but I got what they were trying to do. And I answered it the way the word answers it. Study to show yourself approved. A worker of the word need not be put to shame. They can't put you to shame when you're in there searching it. And then, hey, some people try to sound really smart outside of the Holy Spirit. Don't do it. If there's something you don't know, just go on and move them on. You know the tree of knowledge you asked me about? The reason I told you good and evil is that's the second part of them. So let's bring the second part to them. The tree of knowledge of good and evil. That's the whole thing. So just throw that at them. Good. Good. Why? Because she wants them to be blessed of the Lord. She doesn't want them to see him in problems all the time. You know, when people hurt us, we can get so offended and mad that we're like, good. Whatever happens to you, happens to you. No. We're on their side with God. You know? We are. Your enemies, you pray for them. It doesn't mean you have to be dismantled by them. It doesn't mean God has called you to sit and eat with them. Nothing like that. You don't need to do all that. But you do need to pray for them, and you do need to check with God regularly. Here, that's an answer for somebody. Check in with God. If you have to go by there or not. I'm doing that with someone now. God, do you want me there? Do you want me to stay away right now? Check in. He's going to answer us because he wants to talk to us. He does. He still speaks. They used to tell me God doesn't speak. They said, be careful if you think he speaks. I said, well, that's great. How am I supposed to know him? If I'm only reading this in my natural mind, how do I get to know the living one that the epistles talk about? Like God, Jesus appeared to them after he was taken away and the stone was rolled away. He appeared to them to let them know he was all right. And everything he said was true. You want encounters. You want visitations because they hold your faith ground. When you have an encounter with God, guess what? It carries you another mile or two in your spiritual walk. Because these are some hard times. These are, you know, we got people around us tempting us. We got a lot of stuff going on. So, all right, let me get out of all that. Let's keep going. So growth. We're in this, that was 1 Peter chapter 2. Or growth. Desire the pure sincerity of the word of God that you're going to grow. The only way you're going to grow is desiring this with a desire. So let's read verses 3 and 4 also. I got to go back there. Okay, hang on. Unless, is somebody still there? Is anyone in 1 Peter still? Chapter 2. Are you there? Can you read out loud for me verses 3 and 4, please?
Now that you have tasted the Lord is good. So much for people. As you come in, come to him, the living stone rejected by humans, but chosen by God and precious to him.
Is that it, both of them?
3 and 4, right?
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, on that, listen to that. One more. Read that one more time. One more time, please.
Now that you have tasted that the Lord is good, as you come to him, the living stone, rejected by humans, but chosen by God and precious to him.
That's awesome. You're a good reader. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
So now, what is it saying? A breakdown of that? The same way he was preferred by God. You know, Jesus was preferred by God, obviously. The same way Jesus was preferred by God and rejected by people. Okay? You and I are preferred by God, and we're going to experience, oftentimes, rejection by people. That's what that's saying. We're chosen to be preferred. We're chosen to belong to God. We're part of the inheritance, the wealth of the ministry of the Lord. But just as he was rejected, some are going to reject us. And that's supposed to be okay with us. We're not supposed to be confounded by that. We're supposed to be like, okay. I mean, we all want to be popular and accepted, yes, but if Jesus suffered, he said, you're going to suffer, I'm going to suffer. Things are going to... So listen, why are we being rejected by people? Because of our beliefs. You know, when I stayed warm somewhere tucked away in the back row not speaking, I was greatly loved and accepted. When I started rising up and saying, you know, and getting a little bit more outspoken about what I read and how I see things to be, because you're allowed to read it by the Holy Spirit and let the Holy Spirit interpret it for you. You're allowed to do that. Having the eyes of your heart, your spirit man, born again, enlightened with truth. That's why a lot of people won't serve God or go to church more than Easter and Christmas, because to them it's boring. They feel like it makes no difference, whether I live for God or not. That's what they believe, is I go to church and nothing different happens. I said a prayer and it didn't happen. That's not what this is. This is a way of life. This is me laying my life down, and his life is now, I belong to him. This life is now his. That keeps us safe from going to wrong employment and everything else, because we start seeking him. I'll tell you a story, and I got ridiculed for this. I wouldn't even buy a car without praying about it. And somebody said to me, you really believe you got to pray over buying a car? And I said, yes, I do. Right? It seemed normal to me. But to them, they're like, God, just, it's a new car. Why would you have to pray? Just go pick what you like, you know? So I said, no, I still pray. And I had seen a couple, and I didn't get a, just you kind of get an okay in your heart. I said, some people say, how do you know when God answers? If you don't hear him or whatever, peace. You have a peace. Even if you feel like I don't want to do it, there's still a peace that you're going to do it. You know, God will take over in that. So I get the car. This person was so like obstinate with me that you just don't do this. I get the car. And it wasn't even maybe a couple months later that the Dodge Caravan or something had faulty brakes in it. And like people were crashing and dying with this brand new car that came out and van. And I heard about it, and I actually said right there, that's the reason I pray about things. I don't think God wants anybody to crash and die. These are man-made cars. You know, pray about the car you buy. Pray about the job you're going to take. Pray about those things. And ask, and he'll give you a check. If you don't hear his voice, or he doesn't talk to you the way, or come to you the way some people, you'll get a check. You're not alone. The Holy Spirit is in you. So he's not going to let you drive off somewhere. You know, come on. As long as you're like engaging with him. When you're doing things independently, please don't blame the Lord. Everybody in the world's doing that. Okay? Everybody. COVID's God. Unhappy marriages, God. Stop. We got to stop blaming God so that we can know what our part is. So we can know the difference between us, deception, world issues, evil people, and evil hearts and intents from what is God. And then we can better serve him too. Like answer. Does that make sense? Amen. All right. So rejected. Now in verse 5, are you still there? Lila? Sorry.
No.
One more. Verse 5.
You also, like living stones, are being built into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, offering spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ.
So there, the work of God's Spirit and Word in our life is being built up. Built up a spiritual house unto him, similar to how a house is built from the ground up. Firm foundation, walls, ceiling, everything similar to that, but in spiritual matters. Now, when we talk about what the Lord is doing or wants to do in our life, we include unity to him, oneness. Number one, growth. These are just some things. There's plenty in here. Go in there and treasure dive for a long time in the Word. It's deep sea diving. You won't ever, you know how I used to collect shells on the beach shore? I'd get all kinds. I'd always go out to Anna Marie Island or, that other one out there. There's plenty of places I went. too many to name. We went to Dunedin, went to a lot of beaches in Florida. But when we would go out there, I was really intrigued with shells. And I mean, I would dig in the sand. I'd go up where the water hits because you'd find the good ones right there under the wet sand a little bit. And I'd have my bucket and I would just for hours and hours. Sometimes I'd just drive out there and do that by myself. And that was just a way for me to escape, get out. And I had all these shells, which I finally got rid of a lot of them. I don't know what I was keeping a lot of them for. But when I went out there, I was in search. Like if they were broken or something, I wouldn't pick them up. I'd get those nice, colorful twisties, unique ones. You know, there's so much in God. But what I remember was I could do it for days, hours, and it didn't matter how much they all looked alike. I would still find one with a different color that was unique. That's how the Word is. Or maybe it's something else for you. Maybe those, you know, you do arts and crafts and you see all those colored beads and the different things like that. Start to see this for what it is. No, don't just listen to someone else. For yourself. Check it for yourself. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, God.
So oneness, growth, growing in Him and being His, like His nature, and then being built up, which includes thinking or knowing like Him. Religion sometimes teaches us to sit and belong, I wrote that, while faith presents to us to go and to become. So closely related, but not exact in the interpretation. We want to be able to interpret God's word. We want to be able to interpret His purposes and plans for our own life. If we want to experience the greatness of God for our lives, then we're going to have to be intimately known to God. If you want that greatness, you know, a lot of people are like, well, I want what they have. I want that gift. I want to be able to heal people through prayers. I want to be able to quote scriptures like they just come off your head, or hear the Holy Spirit like He just sent us to Galatians. I want to be able to do that. Well, if you want that, then remember, the only way that comes to us is through this intimacy with the Holy Spirit. All of a sudden you know something, you know, drops in your spirit. You know what you're supposed to be doing. So think about it. How are we going to experience something we know nothing or very little about? We're not, right? So on to the spiritual house understanding. Maybe a little house organizing. We'll do a little house organizing, right? Clean up, spiritual cleanup. So I want to invite this to be daily. If you're taking notes, or please take this note. Spiritual house organizing, we'll just call it that. Spiritual house. So you, what do we have? We have union with Him, oneness, the Holy Spirit. We have growth, desiring the milk, desiring to grow up in the Word. And then we have being built up upon the foundations of what we believe in. So now it goes beyond just a foundation of salvation, or just my Christian faith is that I was saved and I'm going to heaven. This deeper than that. There's a commitment involved here between you and the Holy Spirit, between me and the Holy Spirit. Jesus said, I must go away that I can send the Comforter. He's a Comforter. He will teach you of all things. He's a teacher. It also says the Holy Spirit is a promise. He's been promised. He's our promise, the answer to the promise. And another word says He's your guarantee. Sealed in the forehead of the Holy Spirit in Revelation. Guaranteed. So you want to know. You want to be intimately known. And it's not hard because He's a gentleman. He's very gracious, very understanding. And He doesn't leave and He doesn't take off. A lot of times we disconnect from Him. Amen. We'll learn more as we apply this. Okay, so spiritual house organizing. Now remember, routine, if you can't do it daily, some people don't believe in daily, but don't use the word daily then. You use it like regularly, use it as a routine. And these are going to be mostly one-liners. So for anybody listening right now that studies in content of book or in chapters, I'm inviting you to one-liners, okay? It's for the content of this teaching. First place we're going to go is, take this note, self-examination, daily, routine, regularly. Self-examination, 2 Corinthians chapter 13. And we're going to breeze through these because I've only got about 10 more minutes, I think. We're trying to stay in with an hour and a half. And Esther's crown is running right alongside that. It used to be like 5 minutes or 15. Oh my gosh, so funny. See, that's what I'm saying. Like, I didn't plan all this, but the Lord, he had something else in mind for me, and that's not what I set out to do. And listen, look, this is another thing. You may set out to be stronger in God or do something different in God, and you might have kind of perceived it to be one way. Don't fail to set out. He may change it while you're going. You know, he'll take care of it. If your yes is his invitation. So as you say yes, you're inviting him. And it may be that you thought, okay, I'll start with a little, you know, daily prayer or something. It might turn into hours like mine did. You know, it could be something else in your life. You start visiting a place where you just want to pray for people, or you want to do a little Bible study, and then it might be you're leading the Bible study. So your yes is his invitation to increase whatever it is that you believe him to set out to do. Amen? Does that make sense? 2 Corinthians chapter 13, and I know it by fact because he's done it to me. Again, I'm pulling verses out of chapters for really one main reason, restraint of time. Because I want to get the spiritual application here. Verse 5. And I want to ask you before we read that, 2 Corinthians 13, 5. Have you ever had someone say to you, come on, are you for real? Come on, are you being for real? Well, in Christ, we need to be for real. So verse 5, examine yourselves as to whether you are in the faith. Test yourself. So this is one thing we need to be doing. Test yourself. Examine yourself, and daily, routinely, regularly, it keeps your spirit in check to your mind and what's happening around you. Do you not know yourselves that Jesus Christ is in you? It's the Spirit of Christ. That's what we're talking about, Holy Spirit. Unless indeed you are disqualified. Don't let the things that play with the mind or your past mistakes or your unknown futures disqualify you. Stay connected. He's going to do his part. He's going to remain faithful. Stay connected. People will come and they'll try to your own family may try to disconnect you. You know how many people they said, stay away from her. Because why? And some people are like, I'm staying away from her. When I didn't know anything, I wasn't accountable for what I didn't know. And I like what I do. I was like, yeah, I've had people tell me that. I'm leaving now. I said, why? They said, because you teach too much. When I don't know the stuff, I can do what I want to do. It's like, okay, bless you. I'll be praying for you. But just how does that sound as a group listening to that? And that really happened. And that person's going to be a husband or father one day with that kind of a thought. Yeah, that would be like just sitting in the seventh grade and them going, why are you still here? You've been promoted on to ninth. No, I'm just going to stay right here. Can you imagine a big grown man at about 25 sitting in one of those little five-year-old school desks, you know, crunching in there, or a woman, whatever? No, he's intended, we just read it, to grow. So self-examination regularly, go be truthful with the Lord. Lord, I felt this. Lord, in my mind, I thought this about this person. Recognize what's going on. He said right here, we are to examine ourselves to see if we're even in faith. All right, next. That was a good one, right? Next is 2 Corinthians. No, let's go. I'm sorry. I wrote this. I want to read this to you. Check yourself. And then I put, we need to be for real. Remember that God is for real. Your relationship with God is with your faith. If you want to write that down. Your relationship with God is with your faith. It's by faith. Okay? So if you have mustard seed faith, that's good. If you have, because that's even mountain moving, the word says. But your relationship with God is going to go through the faith that you have. Faith in him. Remember Abraham's belief in God is what was counted as righteousness. Now, the next thing, let's examine yourself. Examine yourself to the Lord. So two, this is routine, regular. Examine yourself to the Lord. Again, we're pulling these scriptures out. Psalms 139. I've got to go quicker, so just take a lot of notes. This will give you Bible time with the Holy Spirit later. Psalms 139. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God, for your word. And this is going to be 23 and 24. And remember, regularly, Psalms 139, 23 and 24. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my anxieties. Look at that. There was anxieties in David. And see if there be any wicked way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. Daily, routine, regular. Examine yourself. Just sit with yourself. Sit with what you did last night, with what's going on next week. And then examine yourself before the Lord. Now, Lord, invite the Lord into search, okay? If you can routine it, you can stay connected with the Holy Spirit. And then you stay away from trouble. So next is to seek Him. To seek Him. So you got self-exam, exam before the Lord, seek Him. So now you brought yourself there. Search after His ways, Isaiah 55:6. My apologies for breezing through this, but I looked at the clock and I'm like, sorry guys, I know we have somewhere to be. I don't apologize for His word, but yeah, time restraint. Isaiah 55:6. Seek the Lord while He may be found. Call upon Him while He is near. So those are ways that while you're searching to do His will, while you're seeking after Him, you know, that place. Now, some people are like, they'll do it when they know they've got to be somewhere. Like if you set apart a certain time in the day, don't do it like 5 minutes before you go to work or something. Because you want to find that. It says, seek Him while He may be found. So you want to stay in that place until He talks back to you. Yeah. I used to sit for years in a place before the Lord where it was me conversing. And then I'd walk away like, it's a one-way relationship here. He does want to, He might give you a vision. You know, you've had dreams and visions lately. And you know, He might speak a word in your heart that you know came from Him. I was walking in my house the other day and I heard clearly a small, still voice in me of the Holy Spirit quote a scripture in me for somebody else. Crystal was in here for spiritual warfare and had a vision, Friday night for worship, and had a vision of David, who used to be in here, saw him sitting in the back, and she got a song during a song for him, and she went into intercession because the Lord, the Holy Spirit in her, brought to light a prayer need for him, and it happened right here for her. Same Holy Spirit. We read last week in Acts, he shows no partiality. It's us. It's where we're willing to come. Our yes is imperative to seeing more. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Just lift your hands. Just go in your room and lift your hands. If you want to look in the mirror to see who you really are, the mirror of His word, the mirror of your bathroom, whatever. Lift up your hands and just start to talk to Him. Lord, open. Leave Him folded if you want. Open the eyes of my heart, God. How can you ever listen to somebody who's not experiencing anything for themselves? Why? If they're not engaged and experiencing it, I'd love them, I'd respect them, but I surely wouldn't internally digest information that's coming from someone who has never experienced or been through it. That's a word. Amen?
Amen.
All right. Some ways now, make it a priority. Say first thing or early. If you want, that's next. Search after, make it a priority first thing early in any situation. However you want to word that, just prioritize it first thing. Psalm 63:1. And with your heart and affections too. Psalm 63:1. Oh God, you are my God. Early will I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My flesh longs for you in a dry and thirsty land where there is no water. And again, with all your heart and affections. And Proverbs 8:17. With all your heart and affections. I was diving this morning. I love those who love me, and those who seek me early, diligently, will find me. Look at that. You're going to find him. He wants to be found. He's trying to. There's some books I read years ago. I haven't read them recently, but they're by Tommy Tenney. You can look it up. God Chasers, God Catchers, and Something About His Presence. Great books. One of the Chasing God Chasers changed my life. God Chasers, Tommy Tenney. Look it up. Changed my life. There's other one, Experiencing God. It's by Blackbee, I believe it is. His last name, Henry. I'm trying to remember names because this is all old. This was 15 plus years for me ago, but Experiencing God. We did it. We did a teaching in the youth group. That's another one. Very good. If you want those nuggets when you're trying to grow up in God, these writers, these authors are excellent at translating and communicating their experience with the word to raise you up when you know there's something more. So God Chasers is a good one to start at. Okay, Jeremiah 29:13. Jeremiah 29:13. And you will seek me and find me when you search for me with all of your heart. I love 14 too, and it says, and I will be found by you, says the Lord. You will seek me and find me. That's one, that's Pastor Francis, the minister that I'm, licensed through in the organization with the International Ministers Fellowship. He has a book, great book, Francis Frangipane, which I'm supposed to, I think I'm supposed to bring you a copy. I will be found by you, great book.
Oh, what was that?
The last one, Jeremiah 29:13. And you can read 14 too, that's pretty good. And that's with Jeremiah 11, which we all know. I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord, plans to prosper you, have a good end, a good outcome. All right, and then, and you can do this. This can be your Bible study. Like, you can sit down with this as a daily routine. It doesn't take very long to build a habit. You can sit down with this and say, I'm going to sit at the table, whether it's once a week, once a day, whatever, and study these back out for yourself, you know? Go as Jeremiah would go and receive of the Lord. Go as Mary would go and experience, you know, go with that heart that you know God made you for fellowship. They wonder what God wants us to be doing. Why would he make us? Why would he make us if he didn't want to have a relationship with us? This isn't some story. That would be a bad trick to me. I'm just going to say that. That wouldn't be a good father. No way. If I was serving a God that did this, gave me salvation and said, there you go. And you just wait it out and go through whatever. Are we going to have problems? Yes. But again, we never go it alone. That's the biggest thing we can do. When that cancer came close to me, I was serving God, serving ministry, serving animals, working on my job, loving my family. I didn't do anything. You know what I'm saying? That we would think to do something. There was nothing that I could see. And when it came, the one thing that God tattooed on me, as if I didn't read it and know it, he tattooed it, he engraved it into me, was I will never leave you nor will I forsake you. He walked with me in that time. Walked with me. And gave me a testimony that supersedes anything I've ever had before or experienced before. So you don't go it alone. Don't believe that feeling. I feel alone. It's just a feeling. False evidence appearing real. F-E-A-R. Fear. False evidence appearing real. It is not him. It has nothing to do with him. In Timothy, he said, I have not given you that spirit. Whenever fear tries to come around, you start to confess the truth. I have a sound mind. Someone told me start counting, start at 100 and count backwards in a quiet room. Whatever. Just know that God didn't give it to you. That's the final one now. That spirit is mean. And it's up to no good. And it didn't win over Jesus, and it doesn't belong in the camp of God's people. Yeah. Amen. All right. And you can write all these down, you know, speak them. Hey, take that scripture, Jeremiah 29:13. Go ahead. Just do this right there in your daytime, wherever you're at. And you will seek me. Pray it. I'm going to seek you. I'm going to be found by you, God. When I search for you with all my heart, you're going to be right there, God. I'm going to find you as I search. Just start praying or make it a declaration. Yeah. We listen to so many words and we believe so many lies, but then when it comes to the word of God instead, be faithful. He'll be faithful to what we'll give him. He says he's faithful and we're faithless. So if you run out of faith, guess what? God's still doing what God does. We can come running right back. It says the prodigal, nobody came and went and got him. Even Dad stayed at the door over there, waiting and watching and looking. It says the prodigal came to himself and remembered where it was that he ran from. Some people need to come to themselves. And listen, if they're connected to you, pray that they do. When I pray for the prodigals, that's what I pray now, that they'll come to themselves. And that by a miracle of God, they'll hear his voice calling them home. Yeah. Open the ears for him, God. Okay. Last place. Let's see. Oh, my goodness. Look at me. I was busy here. I don't know how I got here on time. This is awesome. All right. So now in works, deeds to him. So the next thing, you've got your declarations. You've got your searching, your seeking, you're making it a priority. You've got all your heart, all your affections. Now, you're working and your deeds to him while it's yet daytime, meaning in the days and times we're in. Matthew 24:36. I'm really gonna pick it up. Matthew 24:36. But of that day and hour no one knows, not even the angels of heaven, but the Father only. And why I pointed this out is there's a lot of scriptures about the daylight, work while it's daylight. Okay, while it's in your way to do it. I pulled this out more to say no one knows the day or the hour. So you've got to work in such a way, like your deeds, your prayer life, your devotional time, in such a way as if you're not seeing an end, so to speak, but you know that the importance of the day is that you're living in the now. So you're going to work in such a way as if in Jesus is coming now. You know, and don't worry, your kids are going to get on the boat and all that's going to be good under the age of accountability. Don't believe anybody's lie, okay? And I'm going to say something else. I've seen deathbed repentance. I've seen God lift people up and take them with him from the deathbed, from that experience where even comas open their eyes and, you know, and whatever they were witnessing or experiencing, they got transferred out of here. So just keep your heart towards God and what he can do. Believe for people, even if they look like they're all over the place, and try to love them and like God says to love them. All right, make the most of the day with God and with others. Personal, here we go, personal with God. Set apart a time or place regularly, daily if you can, routine with you and God to pray. Jesus practiced this, Luke 5:16. We'll just, I might got a couple more and we're done. Luke 5:16. So Jesus himself often withdrew into the wilderness and prayed. So he withdrew and he prayed. So practice that similar. Now our practice place is Matthew 6:6. Matthew 6:6. That's his practice place. He exampled it. I mean, his place, not practice. He didn't practice. But his example. Now here's ours. Matthew 6:6. But you, when you pray, go into that room by yourself, a set apart place. Shut your door, pray to your Father who's in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. This is supposed to be regularly routine, okay? So that's some other stuff. We're talking about how we're going to be built up in the Spirit, how we're going to do our part, because the Holy Spirit's already done his part. Right? Hey, while we're here, go over to 5:6, Matthew 5:6. It's just a chapter back. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. Part of the reason believers are not satisfied or progressing and advancing in God or staying us is because we're not hungry. We're not thirsty. Have you ever tried to give something to eat to somebody? They're not hungry, right? Robbie, you know with the babies, they shut their mouths. You can't force anyone to hunger. And then he tells us we ourselves are supposed to remain hungry. Continual hunger. That's one of the things that kills a relationship with God quicker than anything, is when that desire burns out in us, or it redirects to desire something of the flesh. Something else. So don't let that happen to you. Keep your faith. I like to say this. Timothy says, stir up the gift that's been placed in you through laying on the hands. I like to say, keep your faith stirred up. Make sure to examine yourself to see if you're in the faith like where we first started out. All right, and to conclude this study, woo, we did it. Look at that. And I was just a little bit past that hour and a half line. Okay. Conclude today's study corporate. Here's the last part. Corporately together. Acts 2:1-2. corporately. This is all commissioned of God. It's a way that we can engage in what the Holy Spirit, what God's already done. Stir up. Acts 2, 1 and 2. When the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all with one accord in one place, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven as a rushing mighty wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. We just talked about something. We just had an encounter with two of us, but it was a corporate because of a fast. And there was a breakthrough that came, and I believe that is going to filter through the people that joined in on the fast. I absolutely believe that. Yep. I just believe it. You just got to say that sometimes. You know what really gets them when you just go, I just know it. And winky at them. I know it, you know. I know it. Come and see. That's what he said. That's what the Samaritan woman, who became the number one female evangelist in the Word of God, went back to the men in Samaria and she said, come. Come and see. Could this be the Messiah? Come. Come meet a man that told me all about myself. Yeah. Yeah, they used to call us juvenile delinquents. Sometimes we stay that way in the spirit. Right? Juveniles or delinquent. Come on, we can come on up. Here, he told me this one time. He said the inner courts, the holy of holies, they were the spectators that were on the outer courts, the onlookers. There were those in the inner courts that were, what do you say? They were onlookers out on the inner courts. Those were the spectators. And then in the holy of holies, those were the partakers. That's what God showed me one time about being in his presence. In his presence, you're partaking. When you're standing off in the crowd watching everybody, you're spectating. And when you're outside completely, you're just an onlooker. I was like, I want to be in the Holy of Holies, God. That's where I want to stay, in your presence. And God began to teach me that over the years. He's trying to help us. He wants to help us. I hear Crystal like, are they coming? Let's keep going on the corporate. Matthew, the together, though, this is the last thing we want to keep doing. Matthew 26:20. You remember the Bible says, don't forsake the assembling of yourselves together. And I'm not going to sit and say whether that's in a building, tent, underground tunnel, on Zoom. I'm not getting into that. What we need to do is know what our part is, number one, and don't do it. Don't forsake yourself to be together. And there's power and strength when we come together. Verse 20, 26:20. And when evening had come, he sat down with the 12. That's corporate. That's together. And Proverbs 11:14. This is good, isn't it? God. When you go home, if you try to preach it to somebody, just make sure you got all the scriptures. I used to go home and try to tell them what I learned in Bible school, and it didn't come out right. Proverbs 11:14, where there is no counsel, the people fall, but in the multitude of godly counselors, there is safety. That's God's people. So listen, Jesus said in John 8:31 to his disciples, if you abide or continue in my word, then you are my disciples. So the bottom line, this, the word, and you can get, there's so many different interpretations, translations. There's so many different devotionals to fit right into the working mom or the stay-home mom or the single dad. Or there's so much available right now that we're pretty much without excuse. I always say before you go buy stuff, you know, money is valuable, time is valuable, things like that. You don't want to just go on a mission. Like I told you, Tommy Tenney, I don't normally step out too fast into saying, because I don't think everything's for everybody. I don't believe every book. You got to be at certain levels for certain things. Otherwise, it's just like, whoa, I don't understand this. Pastor said this. Tommy Tenney, God Chasers, was take that. That was a book God used when I was coming to the place from salvation of sitting like a doormat, not doing much at all, not understanding, just thinking I had a ticket into heaven one day, to where I knew inside of myself there was something more. That's why I recommend it. And right now, I could probably sit down and read it and just get joy out of it, because it would just refresh some things in me. So, and there's other books I'll tell you about. We have some things in there. I have told Crystal for years, and maybe we can get together and do it. I have a lot of resources and books over 20 years. I have a whole den full of stuff, boxes full of stuff. There's CDs from different ministers and all kinds of stuff, all kinds of titles. I'm talking thousands, not just like a box. Hundreds of thousands of stuff. And I honestly don't even want it back. Some of it, I haven't done it all. I've done a portion of it. I won't bring everything if I haven't done it, because I still, God told me, put on my heart to get it. But I can bring it, and you guys are welcome to. We just need to build some kind of section in here for it. Or if you tell me I like CDs by Joyce Myers or Beth Moore, or if they're men, you know, Rod Parsley or something like that, I may have them. Or if you a certain book you've been wanting, don't buy it without checking with me, because there's a lot of stuff that I have. If you want something on the spiritual gifts, if you say God, you believe God's trying to pull you into more knowledge of the Word, I may have different stuff. You know, I love one book. I love, I'm trying to think what his name is. It's an Oriental man, very, very brilliant in God. I mean, it's called The Spirit Man. And it was just a great book. I think Turner actually listened to the CD was on, the book was on CD, and we actually listened to it together. Awesome. It actually tells you how the flesh in our outside soul is ours, and it's like a shell. And it's like a shell that's holding God in there and stuff. And he starts to break it down just like you see a shell on top of who God is in your life. That's really good. So if you need something, let me know. Need any books on marriage? I still have some books on marriage. I bought you guys the new ones. And I want to see how that, maybe you're not in it, but the workbook, I do want to get some feedback on the workbook. So, all right, God is good.
All the time.
God
is good.
And it's good because he is good because it's who he is. Please remember that. Like, I'm not telling you not to work and do good things for God, but do it out of a receipt of his love. Because if you don't, it'll seem like a burden. It'll seem like another responsibility. And then if you fall short, guess what? The enemy's going to pounce with your fault. You know, you did this. You didn't succeed. It's not about what you can do in and by yourself. It's about what you can allow God to do through you. See, and who he's going to be to you. So let's go ahead and pray and thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Father, we just thank you right now for your message, God, for us to be able to develop a relationship of a daily response or a need of routine or regularity, that we will find this place in you, not just to come before you half learned or not even knowing what we're doing, but to actually look at ourselves and self-internalize some things that maybe we say or do, or maybe it's addictions or repeated behaviors, God. And then before you receive, just accept that challenge to allow you into those places, God. Maybe it's hurts from the past, or lies we've believed, or again, addictions or strongholds that we're dealing with, Father. So we just pray that this will happen for us, and that in us will be a devotional, just like a devotional, a day-by-day walk with you in prayer, in word study. Lead us to the books. Lead us to the devotions, God. The meetings, the conferences, God. We just invite you in to this walk, that our footsteps would be ordered, Jesus. And the Holy Spirit, we thank you. Right now, we just thank you with all of our hearts that you have been given to us to guide us, to navigate, to be our friend, to comfort us. We welcome the knowing of who you are from every area of all that you bring to us, God, in our mind, spirit, soul, and body. May each one be healed. Miracles to those bodies. Yes, Lord, to the relationships, to salvation, to those relatives that need to know you, God. We just pray people in their pathways, Lord. We pray that night and day, dreams, visions, conversations, laborers just walking around, your people, sowing seeds, dropping cards with scriptures on them, God. Use us, show us. We're not limited, God. Use us. Use us, show us what to do. Download into us just the blueprints of our pathway with you, Father. Forgive each one. Bring your mighty forgiveness to our hearts and to our homes, to this nation, to the nations of the world. God, forgive us for not serving and seeking you first, God. Pour into us great wisdom. Yeah. Water us like just well-watered gardens. The word, the seed that's been planted, Lord. We thank you again for Holy Spirit. We thank you for the gift of salvation, your word, and the places and people in our lives, Lord. Have your way. Keep us safe. traveling mercies, protection, the blood covenant. We just apply the blood of Christ to us and our households right now, to each and every person, God. We just thank you for that blood covering. That blood speaks, still speaks, speaks a better way, God. We know we're covered, Lord, sanctified in you. Bless you, Lord. Bless each one. Yeah, we bless your name, God. Keep us safe, God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. In Jesus' name, amen. Sometimes if I slow down, it's because I'm searching to see if he wants something specifically prayed for. So if you hear me kind of hesitate a little bit, just like he put into Crystal's spirit, she's not talked to David. She's not seen David since he left Soldiers for Christ and moved out of state. But yet she's standing here during a worship song, and she's got her eyes closed and sees his face. And sees him in the vision sitting in the back of the church. There was a need there. Yeah, let's pray for him. Let's do it. Ready? All right. Well, Father, we pray for David right now, God. His baby, Kathy, we just pray for them, Father. You know what they need, the provision, God. You know where they're at. There's nothing too great for you. So we just send forth your spirit, your word, your ministry, heavenly host, to encamp around them. That, God, whatever is burdening them or challenging them or whatever need it is or what you have, that it will be met out of the goodness of who you are, God. Not because of anything we can do, but because of your great love for David and your love for his family. We thank you. We send that word to all of our family members, God. We just send your mighty hand of protection to be upon us and our loved ones. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. All right.